In the last class, we discussed about faults in electrical motors and transformers and how through current monitoring we could find out the defects in these motors, in particular the rotor broken bar cases or the static eccentricity. And towards the end also I discussed about how faults could be detected in the bearings of a motor. Now, from that you will get a clue as to a bearing is a mechanical system in a motor or mechanical component. Is a mechanical component in a motor. And essentially, this bearing fault was nothing but the supply frequency plus minus a mechanical frequency. Okay. This gives us a clue that if I have any mechanical defect frequency in a system where it is being driven by an electrical motor, by looking at the motor current spectrum, I can see side bands around the supply frequency. I'll repeat that again. If I have a system driven by an electrical motor, and this system is a mechanical system. This mechanical system has defects. Okay? So, this is how the defect frequencies are given. So, if I now monitor the frequencies of the electrical motor, I will see these defect frequencies come as side bands around the supply frequency. We will see the genesis of this, how this happens in an electrical motor, and you will be see the how powerful this technique is. For the fact that it is non-intrusive, I need not go near the mechanical unit. Like I was telling in the last class, remotely at my control room, just by accessing the conductors which are carrying conductor to the current of the electrical motor, I can be able to find out the faults in the electrical motor. So, in this lecture on motor current signature analysis, I will basically tell you about the theory of MCSA, motor current signature analysis. And I'll be proud to say that we at IIT Kharagpur has been a pioneer in this since last 15 years. We have done research in this, and many of our publications are now referred worldwide. And we are the first to find out faults in gears or gearboxes which were driven by electrical motors. Actually, not by monitoring the vibration of the gearbox, but just by monitoring the current drawn by the electrical motor driving the gearbox, we could find out the faults in the gearbox. Imagine now, I will just give you a wild imagination. Imagine now that you have to measure or find out the faults in a nuclear power plant, wherein you do not have any access. You obviously physically cannot go there to mount your transducers, but you have the access to the current carrying conductors to the electrical motors operating the different valves, gearboxes, pumps, etcetera, and that is how you can do them. Think of a submersible pump, wherein the pump is underground. You obviously cannot put a vibration transducer going underground, but you can definitely access the current carrying conductor to the pump, which to the motor which is driving the submersible pump, and thus be able to monitor the effect of the motor. In fact, in this class, I will be telling you about the theory of the motor current signature analysis, and particularly how signal processing can be used to find out the faults in this systems. And I will tell you about two case studies, one about the gearbox and another one regarding the submersible pump, and tell you the features of the motor current signature analysis. And I believe in the years to come, motor current signature analysis about a decade ago. Motor current signature analysis was very much in a nascent research stage, but nowadays, in fact, there are industrial products which have come out wherein you can fit on a system and find out the fault only through current monitoring. And I believe in the future, using wireless techniques and motor current signature analysis, you could be measuring remote off places very conveniently. So, you all know this by now in this class that we were somewhere here. We know the 70% of the vibration monitoring, wear debris analysis, where the parent material composition is to be known. But this motor current signature analysis is an upcoming emerging field of CBM. Of course, the essential elements in this motor current signature analysis is based on the fact that the currents have to be measured. Current cannot be measured by an ammeter, because ammeter will only give you an RMS value, and at most with load or defect only the value, the waveform, so the magnitude of the current is going to change. But I have no clue when somebody says my ammeter reads 10 amperes, I do not know whether it is 10 amperes a neat sine wave or 10 amperes a neat modulated wave or 10 amperes with lot of peaks. I do not know that. So, once I see the current waveform to begin with in an oscilloscope and then do its frequency analysis, I get a better idea. So, everything depends on this current waveform. Okay. Current could be as neat as this or as modulated as this. This is how a modulated current looks like, actual measured modulated current. The statistical parameters of these two waveforms may be similar, some of the statistical parameters could be same. So, we should not be misled that looking at a single number that they are the same current. But if you look at the waveform, look at the frequency content, they are different. And this frequency content is actually the indicator of the fault in the system. Okay. And in fact, people use Hall effect sensors like this, wherein they put the conductor here, and these are current transformers. Basically, current transformers are used to measure very, very high currents, and wherein turn ratio is 1000:1. I obviously cannot measure 1000 ampere current, because the voltage induced will be large. So, we will have a transformer to reduce the magnitude, and that is why when you go to the any plants, they have CT coils just to reduce the turn ratio, so that a meter can be used to display. I mean, the same meter could be used to measure 100 amperes, 1000 amperes of current, same to measure the 1 ampere of current. But when you measure 1000 amperes of current, you have to give a step down transformer, and that is why this current transformers are used. And particularly in the field, this Rogowski coils are used. But we will be using Hall effect sensor, because they have a wide frequency range. And as you will see, this green signal here, the frequency content of the signal is different. And then this is very, very cheap. All you have is a data acquisition unit, which will carry the conductor, and then or use one of these analyzers like we have in the laboratory. Then you use it and then do the current analysis. But now let us go to the theory of this motor current signature analysis, and we will see why this is important. Basically, I am talking about the current which is there in a motor. So, for example, in a motor, I have three phases, okay, T1, T2, T3, okay. Or let me simply look into here. So, there will be two types of current in the motor. One is the current which will be responsible for producing the magnetic field, okay, in the stator, and other 90° to it is the current which is responsible for producing the torque and which is rotating the rotor of the motor. Now, if there are three defects at frequencies f1, f2 and f3, these are three mechanical defects which I have taken, and basically they have this three torques responsible for these defects produce three torques T1, T2, T3. Okay. If I sum them up, one is the static component of the magnetic, the first equation here is this magnetic component, okay, the DC component and the time varying component because of F1, F2, F3, and quadrature to it is the torque producing current IST, which is given by this. Okay. Now, if I just add them up, they are all similar, you could have taken also any one of them to demonstrate. Okay. Now, if I see the current in any one phase, if I add them up, it will be nothing but the component of these two together in their respective phase. If I just add them up, the magnetic current and the torque producing current, if I add them up together like this, I will come up with an expression wherein I will get cosine F e minus F 1, F e plus F 1, F e minus F 2, F e plus F 2, F e minus F 3, F e plus F 3, where F e is the supply frequency and F 1, F 2, F 3 are the defect frequencies. So, you see the current which is at in the R phase, you know there are R, Y, B, three phases. In any one phase, the current drawn is no longer I naught psi 2 pi F e t, but these components. So, this becomes I s r is I naught sin 2 pi F e t would have been my ideal case, okay, where this is the supply frequency. Okay. But as soon as I have the defect frequencies F1, F2, F3, these are my mechanical defect frequencies. I will have components of F e plus minus F 1. Or F 2 or F 3 in the current spectrum. Okay. And looking at this, I will know whether if these come around the, basically they are modulating, this torque which is created because of a fault is modulating the current, and because of modulations again I am seeing side bands. So, in effect, if I was to explain you through a flow chart, I have a mechanical unit, which is coupled electrical motor. If this mechanical unit has defects F1, F2, F3, anything, they are basically going to produce a loading torque. Okay. And this load torque is responsible for drawing the current, because there is a load torque, the flux is going to change. The rotor has been given with a load torque. So, I need to produce an counteracting torque to this load, so that the motor is going to run, and this has to be at these frequencies, because they have F e plus minus F 1, 2, 3. So, the current drawn will be having this kind of characteristics. So, sidebands of components of torsional vibration across supply line frequency is the strongest indicator of the faults in the mechanical system. Because torsional vibration are created because of these faults. So, we have presented this in one of our paper. In fact, you can go to our website iitnoise.com to see more about our research findings, and the you can see some of the details of the literatures or the reference papers regarding motor current signature analysis, which we are doing since the 2000s. So, in fact, I will now describe about the experimental setup which we did in the laboratory to explain how motor current signature analysis is used to find out fault in an electrical motor. So, in this case, what we have is a three-phase, two-pole, 7.5 kilowatt induction motor, which is actually driving a four-stage multi-stage automotive gearbox, transmission gearbox from a car. And this gearbox is driving a generator, and by giving a resistance load to the generator, which is a typical setup in a lab, we are able to load the motor through by loading the generator. So, these experiments initially we did at a single speed. Of course, now we have provisions, we can through a VFD drive also, we can do this study at different speeds. But most important was that we artificially created faults in the gearbox, in the automobile gearbox. And then we know the characteristic frequencies of these faults, basically around the gear meshing frequencies. And then we at different load conditions, by loading the generator, we loaded the gearbox. We then analyzed the current, okay, and then found out that the gear meshing frequencies were actually showing as side bands of the current being drawn by that electrical motor. And this is the setup which we had, we still have it in the laboratory. This is an induction motor which is driving an automobile. As you can see, this is a car gearbox. We have a coupling and a DC generator and a loading unit from a resistance band. And the control panel, you will see three Hall effect sensors, because initially we were measuring the three phases. And since this is a balance supply, later on we just used a single Hall effect sensor. And this is a close up view. You can see the three Hall effect sensor to measure the three gearbox. And this is an automobile gearbox wherein we could remove the gears and then put in defect in the gear and then run it. And this is just to give you an idea of the experimental setup. We have a three-phase, two-pole induction motor driving a four-stage gearbox, driving a generator. Generator is being loaded, and we have the current probes to measure the supply frequencies, supply current, and then, of course, to correlate or to find out the fault, we also used a vibration transducer and triaxial accelerometer here. And we recorded all of them in a tape recorder and then took it into a data acquisition system where we did the analysis. And this is the internal of the gearbox. It's a four-stage gearbox. So this is, if my speed was 49.1 hertz, and this is the lay shaft, and this is the output shaft, and then the fourth gear has a 19 teeth, third gear 24 teeth, second gear 29 teeth. So we can find out the meshing. You know, we operated this at second gear, and based on that we can calculate the output shaft speed for a supply frequency of 49.1 hertz, that is close to about 3000 rpm. You know, and then we are having, because of the reduction, we are having the output shaft for the second gear, I think it is a 30.1 is this hertz, and output shaft is only 1302 rpm. So, when we run in the second gear, the gear meshing frequency is 630 hertz, and third gear it is 780, and the fourth gear it is 930 hertz. Well, the gear meshing is nothing but it is time. Just not to confuse. So, F m is nothing but n by 60 times t for a linear spur gear or helical gears. So, this are the views of the gear which we introduce defects in the second gears. In one case, we remove one complete tooth, and these are very hard. So, we use a wire cutting EDM, and we remove two teeth by die sinking EDM, and then we again put them back in the gearbox. So, some of the data acquisition parameters we studied, our focus was 0 to 2 kilohertz, sampling frequency was 4.096 kilohertz, number of data points was 8192 data points, time record was 2 seconds of data which we took, and then we applied no load at, this is the full load was about 5.65, half load, quarter load, etcetera, and then we measured the current spectra and then did lot of signal processing to find out the defects in the gears. So, some of the signal processing techniques which we are used, we know the FFT analysis, normal FFT analysis, but as you know, all these signals become modulated. So, we have to do demodulation, and in this class, I will be mostly giving you examples from the demodulation, though there are other techniques of signal processing which is not there in the scope of this class, regarding wavelet transform and multi resolution Fourier transform, which could be used to find out the signal features or features of signals which are non stationary. And some of the signals out of the gearbox are non stationary, but we are not going to discuss about them in this class, but I will just show you the amplitude demodulated current. And this is what is there, and if you see these are the publications from where this we have had this publications done, and you will see just as a comparison FFT analysis and amplitude demodulation, D0 defect means no defect in the gearbox. If I do the vibration monitoring by putting the triaxial on the tail end of the gearbox, I am seeing the F1 is the input speed, F3 is the output speed, and F2 as the second gear lay shaft speed. These are pretty much available in the vibration spectrum as was expected. But if I look at the current signal, you will see around the 50 hertz, FE, I will see FE plus F3, FE plus F2, FE plus F1, all these sidebands come up. The sidebands are because of the modulations, obviously they are modulated. And to find out these sidebands, I did a demodulation. And this demodulations, by this demodulations, you will see F1, F2, F3 sticking up. And with load or with defect severity, these amplitudes are going to increase. So, nowadays there are commercial indicators, they based on these algorithms, where people just use on a pump, on a motor, on a mechanical unit being driven by a gearbox, they know what F1, F2, F3 is, and they put lot of signal processing features to find out how much is the magnitude of F1 compared to the no defect case, has the magnitude of F1 increased, F2 increased, and then they will set up triggers and alarms to tell you that there is a fault in the mechanical system. Now, as you see with defect D1 same frequencies, you will see the severity of vibration increases, severity of the amplitudes also in F1, F2, F3 are increasing. So, imagine in a current, these are all current, in a current you are able to get the mechanical frequencies of the system which is being driven by the motor. You can see the power of such an unit. Now, imagine you do not have to go inside your mind to close to the gearbox, inside underground to the pump. You can be sitting in your control room, measuring the current, doing this kind of analysis, and all you do is find out the amplitudes at F1, F2, F3 in the current spectrum. Similarly, again with the defect severity, in D2 is where when we have two teeth removed, you can see the amplitudes again going up. Okay, and these are because of side bends. So, key catch is the torque or the defect is going to modulate. Modulation means the current will be having side bends, and side bends have to be detected by demodulation, and the amplitude of side bends will increase with the defect severity. Of course, we also saw the high frequencies because we wanted to see around the gear messing frequencies. The earlier case was 0 to 100 hertz, but if you will recall the second gear mass gear meshing frequencies around 630 hertz. So, you will see a lot of side bands around the gear meshing frequencies. Of course, they look very gibberish right now, but if you have the right kind of frequency estimation and then you have frequency detectors in your algorithm that I will only be looking for these frequencies and monitoring their amplitude, you will do a good job in using motor current signature analysis. But because this came out of our research, I am showing all the possible scenarios which are available. I could be monitoring the fourth gear over the third gear or the second gear depending on my frequency of interest. And this is just to summarize. What we have found out in the vibration and current signatures. You can see to monitor vibration, following frequencies can be tracked: input shaft frequency from vibration signatures, second gear mass frequency from vibration signatures, supply life frequency from current signatures. Okay. This is with vibration, and with defect, how the current will behave: D0, D1, D2. Okay. The current gives a good indicator. Okay. And of course, you know, you can also do, there are many algorithms to do variations in amplitudes of side bands and harmonic of line frequency in the current signal. If the amplitudes of side bands are going to increase because it is in second gear max frequency, FM2 is 630 plus minus 50 hertz, okay, minus 50 plus 50 and so on. Okay. And so on. So, you will see with defect severity, these amplitudes keep on increasing. So, this were out of the research as I was telling, but this only demonstrates that any mechanical unit can be used, I mean its fault can be detected or estimated by monitoring the current being drawn by that motor which is driving that unit. And of course, we could do the transient loads also to do the because the loads are transient or the speeds are transient, this will become non-stationary signals. I will not go into details of the non-stationary signals, but a certain algorithm can be developed, and this actually gives you the motor current monitoring strategy which is being used in for MCSA. It can have a steady current signal and current transients. We are not discussing about current transients. Transients occur when you are initially switching on the machine or switching off the machine, but a steady state current signature, we can do FFT analysis. Sometimes it is difficult to trace the side bands in the normal FFT analysis because of these things become modulated. But once you do the demodulations, we would have seen the soft frequencies become detected. But of course, in high frequency demodulation, because of the gibberish nature of the high frequency signals, it becomes difficult to trace the gear missing frequencies. But then there are other methods like the multi-resolution Fourier transform. If you want to know more about these details, it is there in our research publications, which you can see. You can very easily see the side bands of the second gear mass frequency and the defects can be very easily classified. Okay. With this kind of an introduction to motor current signature analysis. In fact, in many of the early classes, when I talked about fault prognosis, which we did in the case of a machine, in a lathe machine, wherein we wanted to do prognosis on a cutting tool life fault. We did in fact an experiment on a lathe machine, wherein we monitored the motor current of the lathe machine once it was cutting aluminum and steel, and this is about maybe 15 years from now. We had seen that how this current in the lathe machine changes once it's machined steel, once it machines aluminum, and then we found out that this current definitely carries information regarding load on the lathe spindle, and So, a defect also gives a load and the load will reflect in the current. So, by monitoring and analyzing the current, we can find out faults. In this case, in the gearbox, in the previous case, we found out faults in the lathe machine, and we took it a little further in the sense we went ahead and started to use this technique to find out fault detection in submersible pump. And this is currently also we are doing this kind of a research to find out faults in a submersible pump, wherein if you will see here, this is a submersible pump, which is it's a drain type pump, but there are many submersible pumps. And if you think of maybe your oil well drilling, okay, imagine we spend, you know, crores of rupees to drill under the ocean bed, okay, and they are continuously being drilled. Of course, if and there is one, we drill and then we have, of course, because of the shear pressure, the oil gush out, okay, through the pipe, and then we tap it off and tap the crude line. But once you are drilling it, drill has gone, you know, maybe 50 meters, 100 meters below the ocean bed, and if the motor is developing certain fault, how do you monitor it? Okay. Large tunnel boring machines. Submersible pumps. Oil drilling. Nuclear plants, windmills, basically think of scenarios where we are not able to position our vibration sensor. Position or vibration sensor. So, MCSA is a relief in such a case. We can use MCSA to find out faults. So, here in the laboratory, in fact, we are doing research in this area into finding out more signal processing algorithms to find out these features better. So, we have an there are actually 6 radial vanes in this pump. And you will see my student has actually removed one of the vanes here, okay, because we wanted to again artificially induce and see what are the effects of this on the pump function. And again through doing motor current signature analysis whether we can measure it. So, we again drove this pump through a VFD drive, and then we have this Hall effect sensor, okay, which is used to measure the current, and then we have this analyzer system wherein you can see the current time history, and then you can see the current spectrum. And you see this at a 40 hertz supply frequency, the current spectrum for a normal impeller is given like this. You will see many frequencies coming up, and we can see at a particular gear messing frequencies, because you know you can again in pumps like we have in the case of gearboxes, we have the vane gear messing frequency. In pumps we have known what is known as the vane pass frequency, which is nothing but rotational speed times multiply the number of veins in the impeller. So again, if this vein pass frequency is given by F V, I will see F E plus minus F V or the other way also, and this is what is there in the frequency spectrum. And of course, there will be lot of harmonics. In fact, in this signal you will see lot of harmonics, multiples are there, harmonics of supply frequency. So, if you have the in MCSA, you will, if you have the appropriate signal frequency detecting or tracking algorithm in the software, in the analysis software. We can detect faults in mechanical systems driven by electrical motors using. Okay. So, if we, and this is very, very important. Okay. Just you may not get, just mounting the peak at the supply frequency, you may not get that. Okay. So, in this example at 40 hertz, we again had defects of one vein removed, two vein removed, three vein removed, and then we see the sideband values, okay, at the these frequencies, okay, the lower sideband and its and the left hand sideband and the right hand sideband and their amplitudes. You will see it is observed that the, when the severity of the defect increases, height of the sideband increases, because you will see from -47.4 it has become -44.71, from -62 it has become -58.35. That means around the supply frequency of, so this is around -189. So these values are going to increase. Okay, and then another case was 267. This is the right sideband, this is the left sideband. So, once the defect severity increases, they will increase. So, if somebody is monitoring this ratio, so you can develop many algorithms. I monitor these ratios or I monitor these differences. If these differences go beyond a certain value, I know there is a fault. Okay, so many algorithms can be developed, as I was telling you. Just by having algorithms, better algorithms to detect this, you can find out the fault in this mechanical systems. Okay. Now, another technique, how MCSA is powerful to find out faults in any mechanical system. MCSA can be used to find out fault in any rotating, it has to rotate, rotating mechanical system. Okay. Imagine now I have an IC engine. Okay. Now, somebody asks me, how do I use MCSA to find out fault in this IC engine. All I can do is, you know, you have a crankshaft. To this, you use a TACO, you put a TACO generator. So, because of this rotational, TACO generator is going to produce an EMF. Okay. So, if you, this EMF will have the defect mechanical frequencies of this system will be there buried in this. So, if you do a signal analysis, on this EMF which is generated by the TACO generator coupled to the mechanical system which is rotating, I can find out the fault in the mechanical system. In fact, we in IIT Kharagpur have a patent on this system. This is our patent actually, this is our invention which we have done, that by using a TACO generator on any rotating system, you just attach it, and then we have used it successfully in monitoring the health of gas turbines. Okay, we have done that for the case of gas turbines, that we can find out fault in any mechanical system. It is an IC engine, gas turbine, etcetera. Here, I do not have a motor driving an IC engine. IC engine, I just couple it to a TACO generator. Because the TACO generator is rotating and the rotational power here is the crankshaft, which is being driven, which is the prime mover in this case. And then I am seeing a EMF, which is having a lot of ripples, and all these characteristic frequencies are going to show up, defect frequencies are going to show up in this spectrum. Okay. So, you can realize the power of the motor current signature analysis. It is a very, very powerful, clean, neat technology, provided you do your measurements right and your signal processing right. Submersible pumps, we just saw the example. Reactor coolant pumps, we cannot go inside the reactors. So, we can monitor the coolant pumps, particularly coolant pumps are very critical to nuclear reactors. Now, that is where they control the temperature of the nuclear reactor. I mean, you know what happened in Japan, okay, because there is a, you know, the cooling pumps did not function because they got flooded. The reactor, you know, had an uncontrollable reaction. Okay. So, this is very, very important. Okay. Rolling mills. Rolling mills, there are a lot of motors which are driving the rolls. So, if one of the motor fails, it is going to have a serious effect on the rolling production. Reduction gearboxes in gas turbines, power plants. And nowadays, a good candidate for motor current signature analysis is this electrical vehicles which are rotating, which are moving around. Basically, they are all high power battery driven cars, wherein we have motors basically driving the wheels. Okay. And if there is a defect in this electrical motor, I am going to have a problem. Or this motors drive a gearbox, and gearbox with a speed reduction are driving the wheels. So, I can have some sort of an monitoring mechanism in that. Think of the traction drives in a locomotive. There also, again, the DC motors are used. You know, here we talked about AC motors. Even if you have DC motors, the same thing would happen. Only thing that there will be ripples after you remove the DC current, you will be finding lot of ripples. And these ripples do contain the frequencies of the defect frequencies of the mechanical system which are being driven by such units. Okay. So, in conclusion, if I talk about the previous class, faults in electrical systems. Of course, nobody is asking me not to use vibration monitoring, I can still do vibration monitoring. I can do oil analysis, particularly for the case of transformers. I can do thermography, something which you are going to study in the subsequent few lectures, because there will be a lot of heat generation in contacts and switch gears, and then we can use or MCSA to find out faults in electrical motors and also faults in mechanical systems. And I believe if I use MCSA plus wireless techniques, okay. In fact, we have done experiments on using MCSA and wireless, and if you go to our website, and then if you will see the experiments on the virtual lab on mechanical systems, you will see virtual lab. In fact, you will see the different virtual lab on mechanical systems and signal processing. You will find out there are two experiments, one on using MCSA to find out faults in gearboxes, another is to find out faults through MCSA and wireless techniques in industrial blowers. Okay. Thank you.